finally, we do our very, very best to keep this show PG-13, but we do not always succeed. So I apologize in advance to those of you who have small children, but think of it as an opportunity to open up communication about where babies come from. What are you doing on my fracking stage?
Well, I was going to come out in lieu of you and say, you know, Wil Wheaton looks like he put on a little bit of weight and lost the beard. But
I would have believed it.
Yes, absolutely.
No, I really just came out here to say hi, everybody, and frack you, Wil Wheaton. Comedy and music and storytelling, not necessarily in that order. Please, if you would, welcome to the stage my very good friends and co-conspirators in many events, Mr. Pollen Store.
Like tachyon particles.
Hi everyone, we're Paul and Storm. Otherwise, the vast majority you need to sit through in order to see Wil Wheaton perform later. We are the thing your parents warned you about, you old little children in the audience.
Yes.
Wow, there are a whole hell of a lot of you. He wasn't kidding. As Will mentioned, there will be some bad words said over the course of this panel, but you know, what else do you want for 10:30 in the morning, right? Most of the bad words will be said by us. Okay, are you ready for roughly 28 minutes of pandering? So let's take this off.
You're not going to get any younger, you know. Winter is coming, I'm growing impatient, and you still got two whole damn books left to go. So write, George, write like the wind. I curse the day that my friend ever loaned me an old dog-eared paperback called Game of Thrones. How could I know that this seed would grow into an addiction that held me right down to my bones? Now 5 books later, I work with the masses, indignant, entitled, and waiting for word that the Great Bear Glacier has finally published 900 more pages of Crack for the Nerds. Why does every new verse of your song keep taking you so goddamn long? George R.R. Martin, please write and write faster. Please give us boiled weather and sigils and seal. We need our allotments of incest and intrigue and 6-page descriptions of every last meal. So write, George, write like the wind. Lewis took 5 years to chronicle Narnia. Tolkien had 12 years and Rowling took 10. Lucas spent nearly 3 decades on Star Wars and beyond on how that one turned out in the end. You're not a machine, and we don't mean to dictate how you spend your days. But please bear in mind, in the time that you had, William Shakespeare churned out 35 friggin' ways. And if you keep writing so slow, you'll hold up the HBO show. And George, while you're at it, stop killing our favorite characters, please. and write, George, write.
Let the wheel. George R.R. Martin, please write and write faster. Before you are dead, George, please write like the wind. Thank you. So that's how this one's going to go for the rest of the morning. Can we get a little bit more guitar and his voice in the monitor, please? That would be lovely. This next one is actually very short, so we're doing sort of a greatest hits highlights version of the Paul and Storm show this morning. This is part of a whole series of very short songs we wrote for Dungeons and Dragons. You can feel free to purchase this song and then use it at your own home games.
Critical hit, how you like that shit? Maybe that's what you call another critical hit.
You want to do that now?
Sure. Okay, we're calling an audible. Because you guys are cool. This is a song about an American hero who died a number of years back. But he was not very well known, at least to most folks. We certainly had never heard of him until we read his obituary and realized that, of all people, this man deserved a song to be written about him. Because he has affected every single life of every single person in this room, whether you know it or not.
In fact, he was so worthy, it should have been written by somebody else. Springsteen, someone like that.
You may feel free, because this is one of those type of songs, to prepare your lighters for waving, or your lightsabers, or your lighter apps.
Yes.
Or really looking out at this crowd, you might want to whip out your laptop and write your own lighter app.
So this is for a hero named Dr. Robert C. Baker.
Robert C. Baker died on a Monday. We all know his work, although few knew his name. A Cornell professor who taught poultry science, forever enshrined in the Poultry Hall of Fame. 84 years worth of food innovation, chicken dogs, and turkey ham. But beyond them all stands Baker's greatest creation, for Baker begat chicken nuggets for man. Baker, way back in the 50s, changed the way children and college kids eat. When he invented a way to get breading, to adhere much better to raw chicken meat. His new method led fast food chains in the 80s to develop and market money bite-sized snack food made from mechanically returning anti-foaming products. Reconstituting meat slurry and extra chicken skin for its binding properties. Oh, Nugget Man, oh, Nugget Man, hit on that
smack. Look, a wild wheat appears.
Wild wheat.
The king of the
world, the only with papa,
the colonel has a salute. The churches are silent, but for Wendy's weaning. Robert C. Baker's last will was specific, that his bones be removed, and he be ground up real fine. It's a place his remains in small cardboard coffins and bury the pieces six at a time.
Everyone!
Oh, dying man, oh, dying man, heading on down to that old promised land. Dipped into his honey mustard and grain, remind the dying man he's on our way.
By the way, Will, Jonathan Frakes is a better kisser than you are.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, that's right, I said it. I'm speaking truth to power. So, this next song is a cappella, which means in the style of Caps or something.
Con style, I think.
Yeah, in the style of the con. Which means we're going to stand around for the next 6 hours.
You can find us outside.
That's easy. Plenty of time for that later on. It's an errant pirate.
The errant pirate is my Jimmy Buffett company.
Yeah. For those of you who aren't familiar with the Paul and the Storm Ubra, that's a little game that we play. You'll be really sick of it in the next 20 minutes, we promise.
Which is our Dave Matthews government.
It is on! He's really good at this game. Anyway, this next song is based on a true story. The very short version of the story is... we read this on the internet, so we know that it's true.
Yes.
There was a convent in Italy that had only 3 nuns remaining in the whole convent.
Completely true. That's the symbol for completely true.
Even though there was an ASL interpreter from the chat.
Oh, it's not ASL.
Anyway, so 3 nuns left in the whole convent, and the local bishop had to close the convent. But the reason he had to close the convent is because, and we are not making this up, a fistfight broke out among the 3 nuns.
Completely.
So Storm and I wrote this next song inspired by what we figure these nuns probably had to do to earn a living after having been kicked out of nundom. Been kicked out of nundom is my Sinead O'Connor cover band. Check it up on the Wikipedia. That'll be funny.
It's always best when jokes are appended with Wikipedia.
Yeah. Yes. Only the best jokes have footnotes.
Which is our Paul and Storm cover.
Yeah. Oh.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present our title bout for the evening. In this corner, weighing in at 114 pounds, by way of the Sisters of Our Lady of the Immaculate Bright Cross, with a record of 23-1, with 15 knockouts, 3 TKOs, 2 decisions, 3 conversions, and 1 exorcism. The High Priestess of Penance, the Pounding Penguin, the Assassin of the Passion, the Stinging Nun, and the Roman Catholic Wrecking Ball. From Dublin, Ireland, Sister Mary Catherine, the Habit Breaker, in Viola Tuck.
weighing in at an even 82 pounds.
She lost some weight.
Yeah. By way of the order of...
Now I'm going to mess up.
And in this corner...
Even 81 pounds. She's still losing weight.
20 pounds. She's a baby. By order of the... By way of the order of St. Adelaide of Perpetual Confrontation.
If at any point during the song we get too slick and professional, please stop us. No remember how song go anymore, make face mouth noises.
With a record of 66-6, with one disqualification for using a ruler. The Vatican vixen, the pontiff's pit bull, the original sinner, the homicidal bride of Christ. The assaulter from the altar. The Undertaker. And the Mother Superior of Kicking Posterior. From Mexico City, Sister Maria Teresa Garcia Graciela Aguilera Delgado Francisco Diego Arroyo Inigo Montoya Zapata Paquito El Guapo Abelita De La Boom Boom. Now let's get ready to
rumble. I gotta have to press the buttons now. Which is my Thomas Dolby cover band. Let's see. Let's do this. And you can go ahead and bring up the video over there now if you would like. Thank you very much. Hey, look, that's us. First of all, we'd like to do a little shameless marketing. We are at booth 3002, which is right next to the Geek and Sundry booth in the gaming area. We'll be there most of the weekend. Please come by and purchase all of our many fine products.
Woo! Or just say hi.
Or just say hi. For example, some of those, we have a relatively new shirt, certainly new to you because we've never been to this con before. Every successful band t-shirt, according to focus groups and test marketing, needs to have the band's name, logo, and website. So we now have the official Fall of Storm t-shirt with our logo, our band name, and our website on the back. You also can be free to purchase the official Fallen Storm Blank is the name of my blank cover band t-shirt. It comes with a washable, erasable marker for making the joke over and over just like us. For those of you familiar with us, we have a brand new t-shirt, the Fallen Storm I Endured Blank Minutes of the Capital Death. Also comes with a washable marker so you can update your results. Finally, we wanted to show you a thing that we found. Because it's important. It being the best 36 seconds. This is a bold claim, we know. We don't make any claim towards having created this, but we will still take full credit for it anyway because we're here and whoever made it is not.
It's the Glee method.
It is.
Which is our Jonathan Colton cover band.
So anyway, there's a lot of internet. How can we possibly say with any kind of authority that what you're about to see is the best 36 seconds on the internet? Well, let's just let the footage speak for itself. Here's hoping the audio comes through.
Crank it.
Crank it.
Funnier than 129th time. You can go ahead and kill the video, but we will be having some audio coming from this laptop for our last song before we bring out some dude who is on some stupid show. And who has a beard that is far less impressive than mine. Because I am rocking the Frakes. Guess what? We're gonna do two songs.
Woo!
Thank you for the reminder.
There's a whole thing about foul language.
this one, it's justified because it's important, because this is an activism song. This is a song that has actually engendered social change in the real world. We wrote it a couple of years ago, a year and a half ago, I guess. Around the time of Thanksgiving. It is called Thanksgiving, but what it is about, well, you'll see what it's about.
Do we have the guitar right now?
There it is. Can you guys hear that now?
Yes.
Beautiful. This song is important. It comes from the heart, and it is dedicated to Mr. J.J. Abrams.
As this time of year comes round again, I find myself reflecting on all the things for which I am grateful, like my family and friendships, and the fact my life is relatively free from pain and tragedy. There's so much I am thankful for, but still, if there's someone or something out there responsible for all of this and listening to me thank them, then I ask you, sir or madam, would you kindly tell George Lucas to stop screwing with our trilogy, and on behalf of all of us, say, George, please fucking stop. And I'm thankful that Joss Whedon is directing the Avengers. Directors, hey there, George. A movie is a snapshot of the era it was made in, like a painting or a photograph or even this song's lyrics, and it won't go back to change them. If Avengers ends up sucking, we'll just shrug and then we'll go make something new. So fucking stop. Everybody knows Darth Vader didn't say a goddamn word when he threw the Emperor down the Death Star to his reactor shaft. And everybody knows that Greedo never even fired. When Han shoots first, it sets up his entire moral journey. Plus it's cool. Things, it's just a first world problem, and there's many more important issues. Even so, I'm asking you that if you're not too busy with the problems of the universe, if you have a moment, I would sure appreciate if you drop in on Mr. Lucas. Maybe grab him by his bent beard and then vigorously shake him. And St. George is very simple. Just release the goddamn Blu-rays with the versions we remember. And shut up and take our money and then please fucking stop.
Song for you. No. Don't get ahead of yourself. Storm and I are currently appearing on a web musical called Learning Town that we wrote. That is on the Geek and Sundry channel. And you can go and watch it. But it speaks to our great inherent love of musicals and the musical theater.
It does, and I feel like Learning Town wouldn't have existed without this song. We have two questions for you. Do you like musicals? That's great. Let's see what happens on the second question. Do you like video games? Great, because right now we're presenting for you Frogger, the Frogger musical.
Never stop us, baby. How about
stuff, Wil Wheaton!
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. Colin Storm! As part of my job, I get to tour around the country and have a front row backstage seat to that all the time. I'm really worried that the universe is going to catch on to that and make me do real work someday. Good morning, Seattle.
Good morning!
I've been coming to this con for like 5 or 6 years, and every year it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And in fact, I think you can probably have fit the entire con the first year I came, right here in these empty seats. Oh, that reminds me, the Minion Monkeys backstage told me that there are still people who want to come into the theater, so if you see empty seats around you, you should very rudely and chaotically climb over the people between you and them and fill in those empty seats so the people who couldn't be bothered to get up early, like those of us in the audience who are responsible, those of us who did not go out and have whiskey last night.
Yeah!
Even though we really wanted to, and someone in the bar was offering to buy it for us,
damn,
and fill in those extra seats. So I love the Pacific Northwest. I really feel at home up here. And we were in Portland on Wednesday. You know, it's funny, they said the same thing about you. I honestly don't see a whole lot of difference. I mean, for someone from Los Angeles, there's basically New York and everything else. You're welcome. So, as we were getting ready to go, to Portland, my wife and I were watching Cops. Which, by the way, shouldn't be called Cops. It should be called Shirtless Confused Meth Head, who doesn't really know how the drugs got in his pocket or into his body, and doesn't understand that he does not have to answer a question the police ask him. Cops was shot this particular episode on location in Portland. Okay. And the very first part of this show was the police going on a call to address a problem that had arisen in downtown Portland. And it was a naked guy riding a bike protesting global warming. And the police said, well, we're going to go ahead and call this a suspicious person. There's nothing suspicious about that in Portland. Venn diagram out of them, Portland is at the center where they all overlap. What would be suspicious in downtown Portland is a group of teenagers without face tattoos and not hassling you for money. But I really love going there. My sister lives there. My sister and her husband live in Portland. They moved up there a few years ago, and they just had their first baby. I know, that is the appropriate response. And it's awesome. And my wife and I went up to Portland right after he was born to meet him. And we were really excited because our kids are grown. And like, my wife and I are in our 40s, and all of our friends who are in their 40s, who are stupid and are just now starting families, who think that it's going to be awesome to have a teenager when they're almost 60 years old. Like, that's going to be great. I am only 18 years older than my oldest stepson, and I've never been cool to him. Until like 3 years ago, like, you know, something happened and I became cool. It had something to do with me being on the Big Bang Theory. But whatever, I'll take that. It doesn't matter. So we go up to see my sister and her husband, and we get up to their front porch, and we're really excited. We've never seen the baby before, and they open up the door, and there's my sister, who she's 36, but is my little sister forever. She will always be my little baby sister. And there she is, and she's beautiful, and she is a woman, and she has a baby, and her husband is standing next to her, and they look like a painting, the three of them. And they're just, it is just like the most heartwarming thing in the world to see this like young family. And something snaps in my brain, and I become like the protective older brother, and I go, did you fuck my sister?
Because I am holding the evidence! We got through it. It's all right. I realized, now they have a family. They don't ever have to have sex again. Because now that he is married with a child, soul-crushing responsibility will be a more effective big brother than I ever could be. They asked my wife and I if we would be my nephew's godparents, which was really an honor for us. And we said yes. And to let them know that I was serious, I took the responsibility very seriously. I had a horse's head delivered to their bed. Really great, you guys. My sister called me and was just like, I'm never going to forget this. And I'm like, I know, right? There's a little bit of some weirdness between me and them because I'm a nerd. And my sister's not a nerd. And my brother-in-law is the antithesis of a nerd. He is a jock. He's a sports fan. And he's not just a sports fan. He's a Dallas Cowboys football fan. That is exactly what I said. So there's like this little... So I'm trying to help. When I said I'll be his godfather, I said it's really important to me that I'm involved in his life and that I sort of help him learn the ways of being a nerd. Because, let's face it, that's the future. We're running the world now, you guys. I mean, it might be athletes who have all the money and all the sex, but we know how to configure send mail, so... there's this interesting dynamic that plays out among us. It's sort of like, my nephew is Anakin Skywalker, and I'm Obi-Wan Kenobi, and my brother-in-law is a Dallas Cowboys fan. So I did this. After we accepted the responsibility of being his godparents, I went home, I went straight to the internet, I went to thinkgeek.com. I bought my nephew everything. And I just had to ship it all to my sister. Overnight, $12,000. This didn't go over well. My sister calls me, what am I supposed to do with all this shit? First of all, you're welcome. What am I supposed to do? He's a baby, Will. What am I going to do with a solar radiometer? Oh, I don't know. Maybe put it in the sun? Does a baby really need swords, Will? Does a baby not need swords? You hang him over his crib like a mobile. And every morning when he looks up, he sees Longclaw and he knows that he should be a moral man. I think he's gonna be okay. I think he's gonna get the nerd gene. My parents don't have the nerd gene, but I got it, so I turned out okay. I don't really know how the nerd gene is passed along. Science doesn't understand the nerd gene at all. Which, if you think about it, is kind of ironic. My parents aren't nerds at all. My mom is really obsessed with being cool. And like, I'm a parent. Guess what, guys? The instant you become a parent, you're not cool anymore. It's done. It's gone forever. And the best way to ensure that you're never cool in the eyes of your children is to try to do things that they think are cool. That is a direct, one-way express ticket to You're So Lame Town. So I write these stories on my blog, and I wrote the story about how when I was a kid going on auditions, my mom I'd be in the car with my mom for hours every day after school, and I would go like all over Los Angeles, 3-4 hours in the car, 25 miles, and my mom would make me listen to the worst music ever in the car. And my mom was really, really, really like profoundly like guy auditioning for a drag show into Barbara Streisand. Like, Barbara Streisand was my mom's spirit animal. And I wrote this post on my blog about how I just hated it.
And my mom calls me up. You know, Will, I think that you're misrepresenting me to every major blog. Really, Mom? Time out. Again. We listen to cool music in the car. We listen to Boston and Led Zeppelin and the Doobie Brothers and Pink Floyd and the Beatles. Right, when Dad was driving. No, I listened to it too. I never made you listen to Barbra Streisand. Really, Mom? Really, Mom? I am a woman in love, and I'll do anything to get you into my world.
How do I know that, Mom?
I know that because you waterboarded my ears with Barbra Streisand. I'm confessing to where all the WMDs are. It's terrible. My dad doesn't really care. My dad is really cool. My dad is so cool that he just like doesn't have a fuck to give about like what anybody thinks about it. Which is why my dad wears Birkenstocks with Argyle socks and muscle builder pants, a Hawaiian shirt, and a fanny pack to hold it all together. So, like, hipsters love my dad. Until they realize that he's not doing this ironically. But together, my mom and my dad make this fantastic a team of cool and just comfort. They are like if Ferrari made a minivan. And called it the Tempur-Pedia Rosa. it would be like a sports car with a sleep number. I have a secret admirer. I know, it's really exciting. My secret admirer sent me presents. No, it's great. Things just show up at my house, and they're like things that I want, but would probably not buy for myself. So, like every Pink Floyd box set just shows up at my house, like all these super expanded editions with all the outtakes and the stuff that they were like, we should not release this until we're in our 60s and need money, then we'll release it. And like the super deluxe versions of video games, right? Like the issue of Borderlands 2 that is delivered to you by an actual bandit. sometimes just like MP3s from Amazon show up. Like I would like maybe I heard a single on the radio and like the whole album will arrive the next morning. It got a little creepy when my secret admirer sent me one of those Archie McPhee rubber horse head masks. This is when my wife figured out that my secret admirer is drunk me. So it got a little weird, and I decided that I would, after I floated the idea of a three-way, did not go over well. Turns out she does not want to have sex with drunk me. Can't say that I blame her. I decided to end it. I'm going to break it off with drunk me.
Aww.
Yeah, so, I didn't take it well. Drunk me understood, sent me all 5 seasons of Doctor Who on Blu-ray, just like as a thank you. And a Taylor Swift mixtape. And then I felt bad, right? Drunk me just wants me to be happy. He's not really asking for very much in return, right? Just a little attention, a little affection, right? So I'm thinking I'm probably going to string drunk me along for a little while. At least until PlayStation 4 comes out. And like, look, you guys, honestly, if Anne is out of town, maybe I'll let drunk me come over and jerk me off. thinking, wait a minute, that sounds like a really good deal. Like, half of you hate me, and half of you hate yourselves. I would like to bring Paul and Storm back out onto the stage. Time. What time are we supposed to finish?
Yeah. I like you put it that way. What time are we supposed to finish?
Well, I just know that we have a ship to sail, so.
What do we have till 11:50? Is that correct?
Oh, we're fine. Fetch me my cape of dicks! That is the love theme for Cape of Dicks. This Cape of Dicks. Hold on, I just got a clasp on it. It's fancy. It's fancier than the previous Cape of Dicks I had, which was just, you know, you just tied it. But this one.
I like that you have multiple Capes of Dicks for multiple occasions.
Multiple Capes of Dicks is my Village People cover band.
This Cape of Dicks was made for me by a burlesque performer here in Seattle. Her name is Scarlett O'Hare Dye, and she has, I'm guessing, maybe there's some burlesquers over here. And she performs an act that I saw last night, where she comes onto the stage as Wesley Crusher in the ugly gray spacesuit, and then transforms like a phoenix into me. It's pretty amazing.
Or you might argue that she devolves into you.
Sure, I take that. The important thing is there was a mostly naked woman on stage last night celebrating my existence.
Which is my Lady Gaga cover band.
When I was watching the show last night, toward the end of the show, I realized that I really had to pee. And the only other place that I ever have to really pee, and it's like not appropriate, like I just can't get up and go to the bathroom, is like when I'm in the car. And when that happens, what I'll do is I'll just like undo my belt because it takes the pressure off my bladder. So I automatically start to do that and realize I'm in a burlesque show. And then make it worse by just fumbling around my crotch, trying to put it all back together. It's great. The secret word for today is cape. Long way to go for that. So one of the things that we do when we do our show Woodstock is we take stories that I've written that are marginally amusing and turn them into amazing amalgams of music and storytelling that are marginally amusing. So we're going to do that for you today, and then we're going to take some questions from you folks in the audience, which is always fun for us because we don't have to work very hard. So. This is a story that I wrote. Oh god, my pages are out of order.
Uh-oh.
Hold on, this is a mess. This is a nightmare. Hold on, okay, we're not gonna
Cape of Dicks. I already came up. Cape of
processor that lets you put numbers on a page. Okay, that's okay.
See, I have mine on an iPad because I live in the future.
Was written many, many years ago when my kids were little. They were like maybe 6 and 8, I think. And it's about the 4th of July. And it's called Fireworks. And it goes like this. When I was growing up, My family always spent 4th of July with my father's Aunt Betty and Uncle Dick at their fabulous house in Toluca Lake, California. It was always a grand affair, and I look forward to spending each Independence Day listening to Sousa marches, swimming in their enormous pool, and watching a fireworks show on their back patio. This fireworks display was always exciting because we were in the middle of Los Angeles County, where even the most banal of fireworks, those stupid glowworms, are highly illegal and carried severe fines and the threat of imprisonment should we be discovered by the few cops in Los Angeles who are not beating somebody up for no good reason. The excitement of watching the beautiful cascade of sparks and color pouring out of a happy flower with reports was always enhanced by the knowledge that we were doing something forbidden and subversive. Yes, even as a child, I was already on my way to being a dangerous subversive. Feel free to talk to any of my middle school teachers if you doubt me. Each year, the older children, usually teenagers and college age, would be chosen to light the fireworks and create the display for the rest of the family. I was chosen in 1987, when I was 14. The younger cousins with whom I've sat for so many years would now watch me the way we had watched Tommy, Bobby, Richard, and Mike. And it turns out that New Edition were my cousins. That's not true. And Crazy Cousin Bruce, who always brought highly illegal firecrackers up from Mexico. I was 14. I was going to be a man in the eyes of my family. This particular 4th of July was also memorable because it was the first 4th that was celebrated after Stand By Me. And at the time, I had become something of a small celebrity around the family. Uncles who had never talked to me before were asking me to sign autographs for people at work. Older cousins who had always been mean to me were proclaiming that I was cool. And I was the recipient of a lot of unexpected attention.
Just as long as you wear people of dicks.
I was initially excited to get all of this newfound attention because I had always wanted to impress my father's family and make my father proud. But deep down inside, I felt like it was all just a sham. I was the same awkward kid I had always been, and they were treating me differently because I was a minor celebrity, which I had already realized was fleeting and bullshit. Looking back on it now, I think the invitation to light fireworks may have had less to do with my age than it had to do with my then-growing fame. But I didn't care. I mean, fame is fleeting, but I can get a guy some cool stuff from time to time if you know what I'm talking about. Like all 5 seasons of Doctor Who, I'm sure. I allowed myself to believe that it was just a coincidence. The day passed as it always did. There were sack races, basketball games, water balloon tosses that turned into water balloon fights, all of which I participated in, but with a certain patience. These yearly events were always fun, but they stood directly between me and the glorious release of pyrotechnic bliss. Finally, the sun began to set. Lawn chairs were arranged around the patio. Clothes were changed, and I bid my brother and sister farewell as I joined my fellow firework lighters near the corner of the house. The sun sank lower. Sparklers were passed out to everyone, even the younger children, because putting a piece of wire that glows at 600 degrees in the hands of a toddler is something that can never go wrong. I politely declined, my mind absolutely focused on the coming display. I wanted to make a big impression on my family. I was going to start out with something amazing, something that would really grab their attention, like some ground flowers, followed by a piccolo peat, then a sparkling cone. After that, I would improvise with the older, more experienced cousins, following their lead as we worked together to weave a spectacular tapestry of burning phosphor and gunpowder for 5 generations of family. The sun finally set. The family was finally seated, and the great display was to begin. Some of the veteran firework lighters went first, setting off cascading fountains on a pinwheel. The assembled audience cheered and gasped in selective approval, and it was my turn.
Do you ever feel like a plastic bag? Wanted to start again. Do you ever feel you're so paper thin? Like a house of cards, one blow from caving in.
I steeled myself and I walked to the center of the large patio, casually kicking aside the still hot remains of just hired fountains. Casually, like someone who had done this hundreds of times before. My hands trembled slightly as I picked up three ground flowers, the fuses wound together. My thumbs struck flint and released flaming butane. I lit the fuse and became a man. Sparkling fire raced towards the ignition point, and rather than following the directions to light fuse, put on ground and get away, I tossed it on the ground.
Just know the night like the
ground
of your life.
The bundle of flowers rolled quickly across the patio toward my captive and appreciative audience. Two of the flowers ignited and began their magical dance of colorful fire on the cement, while the third continued to roll, coming to rest in the grass beneath the chair of a particularly old and close to death great-great-great-aunt. The colored flame, which was creating such a beautiful and harmless display on the patio, was spraying directly at this particular matriarch, the jet of flame licking obscenely at the bottom of the chair. The world was immediately reduced to a few sounds. My own heartbeat in my ears. The screams of the children seated next to her. And that unmistakable zip of the now dying flowers on the patio. Now, I don't know what happened, but somehow my great-great-great-aunt, who managed to survive every war of the 20th century, managed to somehow survive me. She was helped to her feet, and she laughed.
Take a load off, baby.
Fortunately, she was the only one laughing. One of my dad's cousins, who was well into his 20s and never attended family gatherings accompanied by the same woman, sternly ripped the lighter from my hand and ordered me back to the lawn to sit with the other children. Maybe I could try again next year, he said, when I was more responsible and not such a careless idiot. I was crushed. My moment in the family spotlight was over before it had even begun, and not even the soft glow of pseudo-celebrity could save me. I carefully avoided eye contact as I walked slowly, humiliated and embarrassed, back to the lawn, where I tried my best not to cry. I know the rest of the show unfolded before me, but I don't remember it. All I could see was a mental replay of that bundle of ground flowers rolling across the patio. If that one rogue firework had not broken off from its brothers, I thought, I would still be up there for the finale. Maybe I could have lit the pinwheels and the Chinese lantern. When the show was over, I was too embarrassed to apologize, and I raced away before the patio lights could come on. I spent the rest of the evening in the front yard waiting to go home. The following year, I was firmly within the grip of sullen teenage angst, and I spent most of the festivities with my face planted firmly in a book of Warhammer 40,000 rules. And I watched the fireworks show with the calculated disinterest of a 15-year-old. That teenage angst held me in its grasp for the next few years, and I even skipped a couple of fireworks events at Aunt Betty and Uncle Dick's house, opting to attend parties where there were girls who I never talked to. By the time I achieved escape velocity from my petulant teenage years, they had sold that house in Toluca Lake, and 4th of July would never happen with them again. The irony is not lost on me that I wanted so badly to show them all how grown up I was, only to behave more childishly than ever the following years.
What did you do? What did you do? You stand up and walk out on me.
This 4th of July, I sat on the roof of my friend's house with Ann and the boys and watched fireworks from the high school. Nolan held my hand and Ryan leaned against me as we watched the Chamber of Commerce create magic in the sky over Rocker Center. I thought back to that day 15 years ago, and once again I saw that ground flower roll slowly under that chair and try to ignite great, great, great Aunt whatever her name was. Then I looked down at Nolan's smiling face, illuminated in flashes of color. "This is so cool, Will," he declared. "Thanks for bringing us to watch this." "Well, just be glad you're on the roof and not in a lawn chair." "Why?" Well, I began to tell him the story, but we were distracted by a particularly spectacular aerial flower of light and sparks. In that moment, I realized that no matter how hard I try, I will never get back that day in 1987, nor will I get to relive the sullen years afterwards. But I do get to sit on the roof with my wife and our kids and enjoy 4th of July as a dad. At least until the kids hit the sullen years themselves. Then, I am going to make them sit in lawn chairs while I light ground flowers. So looking at my Tinocron, we have about 20 minutes before we have to leave the stage. So, here's what we can do. We can sing you a song about pirates. Or we could answer your questions. I believe our course has been laid in.
Make it so.
Hi, sir.
All right. This song does require audience participation. I see you're very disappointed in that fact. When we cue you, let forth with a full-throated piratical R. Practice it now.
R.
Hit us two times.
R.
Hit us five times.
R.
Little ripple effect from the size of the room, but we will declare it accurate. I heard a lot of rounding up.
Yeah,
a lot of Catholic school students. Yeah. Pi equals 3 point.
Pi equals 3 point Jesus.
It equals 3 and 1 at the same time.
It does.
By the way, can someone with a headset or in authority tell me, is that correct? Do we have until 11:50? Is that so? I mean, come on, we can commandeer this room. Look at how many of us there are.
Yeah, we can.
Tomorrow morning.
Well, no one's going to have to tell us how wrong. Okay. Oh, we're getting the thumbs up.
Yeah, all right. All right, we're going to push this thing to its very limits.
I need more power. This has never been done. We've never done an emergency saucer separation at work for me except for the pilot.
Save the best for last.
I got like contact nerd all over me.
Which is why they might be Giants cover band. Hey!
Oh! All right, Craig, just one more time. The song is called The Captain's Wife's Lament.
Woo!
There's a shirt that's all about it. Ship went into harbor after 15 months at sea. The captain hit the tavern.
You're like the gayest pirate ever.
I'm just puzzling over what his superpower is.
You actually look fabulous. You are, in fact, Fabulous Beard the Pirate.
Big Beard!
Capable of reciting any Barbra Streisand here.
You have no idea how often that need comes up on the high seas. Quick! Someone tell me all the songs on side two of Superman.
Wow, he's committed.
He's so committed, that's it.
Using his dingo vision on the crowd to look for trouble.
Oh, wait a minute, wait. Watch, I'm gonna transform him from Fabulous Beard the Pirate to Ezio the dick-using assassin.
Here we go.
Stories up.
And then it's hits a bullet.
You don't want to know what goes on in that hay bale after he lands. I do, but I can tell you that there's a PlayStation 4 at the end of this. Wow, we're 1.5 lines into this song and we're already 3 minutes in.
That's why I asked the audience if they wanted.
The ship's in the dark, and we're moving like the thing. The captain hit the tavern with his crew of 53.
That's you.
Arr!
Give me an R!
R!
What's that spell?
R!
Yes. Technically, it spells R. What's your favorite letter?
R!
What's your favorite number?
R!
It's an irrational number.
Yeah!
Your favorite captain of the Enterprise?
Picard!
Picard!
Actually, the correct response to that would be beep! Yeah.
What be your favorite kind of socks?
Arr!
And who be your favorite ancient mathematician?
Archimedes!
It is correct. Or Pythagoras.
Somebody said Aristotle, which I've never heard before.
Technically, he was more of a philosopher. Like Barto. Descartes. Who be your favorite dinosaur?
There's too many with the head. It's chaos.
The dinosaur schism.
The dinosaur schism is my...
That's why it was not Will's cover band.
Hey!
I mean, my favorite dinosaur is Barney.
He be nobody's favorite dinosaur.
Who did he play on Star Trek The Next Generation?
That is correct.
Who be the security officer?
Natasha
Yar! You all failed Pirate College.
Oh god, that's gotta hurt. You all failed Pirate College is my great big sea cover band.
Cover band.
Wow, we gotta hurry.
Right. So it's only 2 lines in
into our song.
Crew of 53.
campaign to scatter through the town.
I love being a pirate.
Acting! But all the inns and public houses turned to Salem Town, dejected are.
Oh, sad pirates. But coordinated pirates, you're kind of freaking me out, actually. Because not only did most of you do the sad little pirate thing with your heads, but everyone who did it in the same direction.
I saw a lot of hook hands going.
Well, that was, I guess you're inspired with your acting.
So that's right, you do have a lovely model right up here.
Well, let's see how you stand up. See how you stand up on the Wheaton scale. Give us a pensive, thoughtful arm.
Like put the hook stabbing chin.
Give us I just stabbed myself in my own chin with a hook arm.
Damn it, arm.
Give us a hungry arm.
Everybody's got a hungry arm.
It's the bars. New Jersey.
Henry Park.
Give us a surprise arm. Give us a confused arm. Give us a Scooby-Doo arm. Same thing with a little extra mustard.
Now you all know how to do voice acting.
Yay! Congratulations, you all graduated from the Actar Studio.
You may have washed out of pirate school. But you be voice actors now.
We go work with Phil Lamar and Maurice Lamar. Phil Rockar.
What truck driver did Pee Wee Herman meet?
That was the worst accident I ever seen.
Done a night just like this. Done an audience just like this one. The worst pirate song I've ever seen.
I believe we left off. Oh, holy shit. And dejected are. Captain said, fear not me, lad. You all can come with me. I love you is around the corner, and you all can stay for free. Hopeful are. Or we want to steer the ship from here.
I don't know, it's very warm on this Cape of Dicks.
As it
is it hot in here or is it just my Cape of Dicks?
This is by George Michael Coverman.
Oh, no!
I don't allow it.
Because you're well insulated with the many bonars. You don't need to take Viagra. You're like a penis reaver.
If you wear the Cape of Dicks for more than 4 hours, see your doctor.
Penis reaver is my 80 cop cover band.
Yeah, going old school.
Nice. I looking up nerds.
I would have got Gigi Allen. You're the only person in the room who would have gotten it.
By the way, Look It Up Nerds is my Depot cover band. I have lost my place. George is my Rolling Stones cover band.
And my Fish cover band.
Let us all celebrate Will's joke.
I kind of look like the Fat Albert gang up here.
Now when you tell the joke during the pirate song, it must be relevant to the subject at hand or the audience will get bored. It is very important that the song goes until everybody is completely sick of you and here come the panties.
Here, here come, there we go. Oh, wait.
Here Come Panties is my Tom Jones cover band.
Oh!
Burgers and fries, man. Burgers and fries. Which is my meatloaf cover band.
No!
It's the first time anyone's ever thrown candies at us during our cosplay.
Rudy! Who left all the underwear on the stage? I told you to clean it up before we could go to the fair, and now you'll get no jello pudding.
I don't have it. I came to do this. But I don't have it.
Man, you're just like school on Christmas, Mushmouth. No class.
You got this whole weird sort of foppish Aerosmith vibe going on.
Yes, I do.
Which is my Bon Jovi cover band.
Got to be an inspiration to people who want to go into a rock band just to get laid. Because he is the most unattractive person on planet Earth.
I see you're Steven Tyler, and I raise you Rico Kessick from the Cars.
But Rico Kessick from the Cars could walk around on the surface of a swimming pool.
Point taken.
I believe you meant the Cars.
Oh, that's right, we're not talking about pirates, I'm sorry.
Remember when we were doing a song? Hopeful R.
R.
Such power we wield right now.
R.
Which is my Justin Bieber cover band.
Oh!
Justin Bieber. But seriously, look at the control we could exert right now. Look around at yourselves. If a bomb was to go off in this room, there would be no tech support from here to Eugene.
With great power comes great responsibility.
Seriously, we've got some serious bargaining power in this room.
Right? Oh, there are people all over the Pacific Northwest just turning it off and on, and nothing's happening. No, they're plugging it in, yeah.
All right, we once again left off at Hopeful R. But when the captain's wife awoke upon the break of day, they say that you could hear her wailing, clear to Botany Bay.
Twas not a cue. Twas
the opposite of a cue.
Yeah. All right, band geeks, find the people who are and give them a beating.
Give us a dyslexic R.
This is Tourette's R. This is for me, I love it. Oh, perfect. Okay, we're gonna count to three. You're gonna do one more R. We're gonna finish this goddamn song. Thank you all for coming out. Give it up for Wil Wheaton.
I be ready.
BB ready.
I be ready.
Of course they did, sir.
BB ready.
Excited,
yes.